In mathematics, we often solve for x, but what about y? Whether you really only know basic math or you have a career as a mathematician, there's something within Pascal's triangle that you will find interesting. There's so much to discover within this one triangle that I definitely won't be able to include it all in this video, so I just might have to make a part two in the future. But first, I need to talk about what Pascal's triangle is and how we can make it. We start with a 1, and we can just pretend there's some imaginary zeros next to it. And how we construct the next row in the triangle is by taking the two numbers directly above and adding them together. So for the second row, we're adding 1 plus these imaginary zeros, so we just get 2 more 1s. But it starts to get more interesting as we create more rows. So in row 3, we add these two 1s together and we get 2. Then in the next row, we'll have 1 plus 2, we'll get 3, and a 2 plus 1 and get 3. Then for the fourth row, we get 1 plus 3 is 4, 3 plus 3 is 6, 3 plus 1 is 4, etc. And you can see how this pattern continues. This triangle can continue on forever, but I'm just going to stop here. Now you may already be noticing some patterns within this triangle. First of all, noticing that both of the ends consist of all ones. And that makes sense because if we have these imaginary zeros filling out the rest of the row and we start with a 1, of course we're going to end up with a bunch of 0 plus 1s. I also would like to note that this triangle is symmetrical. So when I start showing you some patterns within the diagonals, just note that these diagonals do also appear reflected on the other side of the triangle. So speaking of these diagonals, of course we already talked about the end diagonal consisting of all ones, but if we look at the next diagonal down from that, you'll see we have 1, 2, 3, 4. Can you see where I'm going with this? That's right, we have the natural numbers, or in other words, just the numbers we count with. 1, 2, 3, and so on. And moving down to the next diagonal after that, we have 1, 3, 6, 10, 15. That may or may not sound familiar to you depending on your math background. So I want to look at this more closely. To go from 1 to 3, we add 2. To go from 3 to 6, we add 3. To go from 6 to 10, we add 4. Are you noticing a pattern here? Well, this makes sense because if the diagonal above this was the natural numbers, then we're going to end up adding those natural numbers to get to this row. So it makes sense that we have this plus 2, plus 3, plus 4 in here. But these numbers actually have a name. They're called triangular numbers. And if we represent these numbers visually, I think you'll see how they got their name. Pretty cool, right? And speaking of triangular numbers, have you ever tried to visually represent the square numbers? Anyways, continuing on to the next diagonal down, we have 1, 4, 10, 20, and so on. We can think of these in a similar way as the triangular numbers, but instead of having circles that we're stacking into triangles, imagine having spheres that we're stacking into a pyramid. These numbers are called tetrahedral numbers. Next, I want to look at a special kind of diagonal within this triangle. Instead of taking the diagonals we've been looking at, I want to slant our diagonal slightly. So first we would just have a 1, in the second diagonal we still would just have a 1, but in this third diagonal we see that it crosses through 2 1s. So I want to add all of the numbers that this diagonal crosses through. So first we had 1, we had another 1, now we have 1 plus 1, which is 2. Moving our diagonal down, we have 2 plus 1, which is 3. The next diagonal, we have 1 plus 3 plus 1, which is 5. The next diagonal, we have 3 plus 4 plus 1, which is 8. Again, these numbers may or may not mean something to you depending on your math background. So let me just write these out in order and see if we can notice a pattern. Well, we started with 2 1s, and then we have a 2, which is the same as 1 plus 1, and then we have a 3, which is the same as 2 plus 1, then we have a 5, which is the same as 3 plus 2. Are you noticing the pattern here? each number in the list is created from adding the previous two numbers. And this is the Fibonacci sequence, which can also be used to find the golden ratio. Next, I want to look at the horizontal rows within this triangle. I want to add each of the numbers in each of the rows. So the first row, we just have 1. The second row, we have 1 plus 1, which is 2. Third row, 1 plus 2 plus 1, which is 4. Fourth row, 1 plus 3 plus 3 plus 1, which is 8. And so on. Notice that all of these numbers are powers of 2. 1 is 2 to the 0. 2 is 2 to the 1st. 4 is 2 squared. And so on. Now I want to look at the horizontal rows again, but instead of finding the sum of the numbers, I want to use each of the numbers as part of the decimal expansion. So what I mean by that is for these first few rows, essentially we're just taking the numbers and making them the digits of a new number. So for example, in the second row, instead of having 1 and 1, put those together and get 11. In the third row, instead of 1, 2, and 1, we put those together and we get 121. That works fine for all of these rows that have single digits, but once we start getting double digits, we need to think of what we're actually doing when we're combining these digits into one number. For example, looking back at the third row, this first one becomes the hundreds place, the 2 becomes the tenths place, and the 1 is the ones place. So to go from 1, 2, and 1 to 121, we're taking 1 times 100 plus 2 times 10 plus 1 times 1. If we add 100 plus 20 plus 1, we get 121. So that's what I mean by the decimal expansion. So looking at row 6, where we have these double digits, instead of just combining them to equal 15,101,051, instead, what we're really trying to do is take 1 times 100,000 plus 5 times 10,000 plus 10 times 1,000 plus 10 times 100 plus 5 times 10 plus 1 times 1. Which gives us a total of 161,051. Well, it turns out all of these numbers are powers of 11. We start with 11 to the 0 power, then 11 to the 1st, 11 squared, 11 cubed, 11 to the 4th, and so on. Math is pretty cool, and I'm just getting started. Also, really quick before I move on to the next thing, turns out you can kind of think of this as carrying the digits over. So we'd start with a 1, we take 5 plus 1 to get 6, 0 plus 1 to get 1, and then 0, 5, and 1. So that kind of works too, but I don't like to give hacks or cheats first without actually explaining why they work and where they come from. This next one is pretty neat, especially if you like visual things. I want to take every odd number and color it purple, and I'll leave all of the even numbers white. You might start to notice a pattern here, which might not mean much to you unless you're a Legend of Zelda fan. But if we extend this pattern farther along Pascal's triangle, remember this triangle continues on forever, so if we expanded this, you'll start to see a really cool pattern emerging. And this is actually called Sierpinski's triangle, which is a type of fractal. Next, I want to talk about binomial expansions. For example, if we had x plus y quantity squared, we could multiply that out to be x squared plus 2xy plus y squared. Notice that the coefficients in front of each of the terms give us the numbers found in the third row, 1, 2, and 1. Let's try it for x plus y quantity cubed. We would have 1x cubed plus 3x squared y plus 3xy squared plus 1y cubed. Again, we recognize these numbers from the fourth row, 1, 3, 3, 1. So each row shows us the coefficients of a binomial expansion. And just for fun, we can tie this back to those horizontal rows that we were thinking of with the powers of 2 and the powers of 11. If we replace x and y with 1, we would get 1 plus 1 quantity squared, or 1 plus 1 quantity cubed, etc. Or in other words, 2 squared and 2 cubed. And we would find that that does get us right back to those powers of 2. Or same for the powers of 11, if we just replace x and y with 1 and 10. So we get 1 plus 10 quantity squared, 1 plus 10 quantity cubed, or in other words, 11 squared and 11 cubed. We multiply that out, then we'll get right back to those previous numbers that we found. The numbers in each row also correspond to the different numbers of combinations that we can make, thinking back to probability and combinatorics. For example, say I have 5 people and I want to know how many ways I could pick a pair of them. Or in other words, I have 5 people and I'm choosing 2 people. So how many different combinations are there? Well, it turns out instead of doing that by hand and drawing out the different pairs, or using the formula to calculate it, we can actually use Pascal's triangle. So I want to move down to the 5th row. However, keep in mind that we're starting with 0. So if I go 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, let's look at what these different numbers mean. So if I have 5 people, but I'm choosing 0, there's only one way for me to do that, picking nobody. But if I have 5 people and I'm choosing 1 person, I have 5 different ways that I could do that. I could pick person 1, or I could pick person 2, or I could pick person 3, etc. So, remember I said I have 5 people and I want to pick 2. This first number corresponds to 0, and I count over from there, so I count over from 0, 1, 2. I land on the number 10, which means there are 10 different possible ways that I could pick pairs of people in my group of 5. So suddenly this Pascal's triangle becomes a really convenient tool for determining the number of combinations and finding probability and expanding binomials. It's really crazy how much can be found within this one triangle that was formed from doing very simple addition. I'm going to end this video now, but there was so much more that I found out when researching information for this topic that I wish I could include, such as how you can find pi in this triangle, or e, or a thing called a hockey stick pattern, or how if you take all these numbers in mod 2 and look at the binary, it forms this crazy pattern. There is so much more to find within this triangle that I bet you could ask so many different mathematicians and they would all know something different about this triangle, and I think we will keep finding more and more as time goes on. So now I challenge you. Can you notice any patterns or find any cool ways to manipulate these numbers to come up with some crazy results? Let me know in the comments what your favorite part of Pascal's triangle is, and let me know if you'd like a part 2. I hope that learning about Pascal's triangle might open your eyes to some of the wonders and magic and beauty of mathematics if you haven't seen that already. I love Pascal's triangle because I think whether you hate math or you think you're terrible at math, or you already love math, you're majoring in math, you think math is awesome, there is something in this triangle that I think you will find interesting and you will find fascinating. And it just shows how awesome and connected everything in mathematics is. And I just think it's really cool. So thanks so much for watching. This was What About Why?